Remove your covers.
Hands on your heart, please. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you.
My bird running under the wall.
Thank you so much.
There you go.
I want to say these things briefly. I prepared a few opening remarks. To grasp what is at stake, we must know what we are fighting for and know what we must have, a true activist at heart. Who saw the speech that bashed Iowa's wind energy? Didn't a Planned Parenthood close in Scott County this week? Thousands of women lost access to basic preventative care. How many legislative seats need to be flipped in the House of Representatives to regain a majority? The Senate? Whose job should it be in each county to ensure a brand new candidate learns about filing deadlines for paperwork to run for office? Administratively, are we too complicated? Are we being reactive or solution-oriented? Who paid attention to the Democrats' plan to fix health care in Iowa that Jack Catch and Matthew McCoy worked on? We have so many groups rallying for so many causes that I cannot keep up. Are we going to wear out our grassroots base? Does anyone know how we frame a message and consolidate all these fractured reactions to the onslaughts and divisions caused by what we have lost and what looms near? It looms near, people. How do you say unify to a group that swings like a constant pendulum? How do you get 99 county chairs to at least try to follow the basics of our party platform? I always thought that we were supposed to be the ones who were to take care of the people who fought for the rights, the inherent needs and dignity against racial and social injustice and all forms of bigotry and intolerance and hatred. I thought that we, the Democrats, we knew that it was wrong to ever build any fortunes or gains upon the suffering of others who had no ability to speak for or fight for themselves in society. The poor, the disparaged were to be lifted up and fed. I believed us to have clarity of purpose, to know our environment must be protected and our resources used wisely. Education leads to freedom of mind minus weight of debt equals lightness of being in a society where pursuit of liberty and happiness and justice for all is a possible truth. Can't we stand for these things? Can't we stand for these things? Could we hope together for more than we have now? For peace? We know the oppressor will not grow weary, and we know plans are well underway for the next session. How can we pull together, putting ego aside, and do what is best for all to affect and influence the most positive change? Because that is our job as Democrats. We fight for all Iowans. That is our job. We are to be the change that we expect. That is what we are supposed to do. We fight for them. So, I will convene this meeting of the Veterans Caucus. This is an IDP chair forum. I expect civility. I expect this to be fair questions. We will not dwell on the past because it is the past and we cannot change the past. The past is over. We are moving forward as a party. in unity. And I will not accept or allow behavior otherwise in this forum. That is my leadership. That is my purpose. Those are my goals. Welcome. Okay. Who would like to go first? Oh, I should introduce myself. I'm Shelley Servidia, Chair of the Veterans Caucus.
Heads.
Tails.
All right.
Oh, she's
so.
Okay, so who's?
There are three of us.
Oh, I'm sorry.
So we have. Julie,
I don't have a three sided.
I go alpha.
Okay.
Yeah.
You can do a PowerPoint, you can do a slide presentation, you can speak freely, openly, talk about your true self, your goals moving forward, how you can run this party, how you can fundraise, how you can unite us. How you're going to handle 99 county chairs who have 99 different ideas how they think they should do things, because we have to frame our message and we have to move forward. We have to kick some ass. So, okay, here we go.
How long do we have?
I think 7 minutes is fair, because we have a long time frame. We have until 11:30. So go ahead. Okay. You have to be leaders. Lead.
Seven, and then the Q&A after that. Or
for the whole group.
Okay. Well, I think the first thing, my name is Bob Krause. I think most of you probably know me from my run for Senate twice and other activities. I'm currently president of the Veterans National Recovery Center, which is a veterans charity. We were quite active in the state legislature. We were temporarily successful in stopping the firecracker deregulation law. We also, thanks to Joe Stutler over here, who's on our board, we were able to knock out the effort to eliminate local option civil rights laws. And Joe started it, and we finished it, and it's still law. I mean, it's one of the few progressive laws that are still on the books after the disaster that we went through this last session. Looking at the state chair, when we organize for battle, as we would here in the Veterans Caucus, we organize with a good cop and a bad cop. The state party chair is the bad cop. That's the one that takes the heat, that points the button, that makes the other side responsible for what they have done to this state. The good cop is our candidate that is above the battle, that talks about the issues. The bad cop pokes the bad guys in the belly button and makes them squirm. That keeps the heat off of our candidate, and they can maneuver more freely. I think that is a key role, and I'm good at it. If you look at my Twitter account, I'm up to almost 35,000 people. On Twitter. I've got Facebook posts we've been doing routinely. We'll run 10,000 to 20,000 posts or views or looks or views. I don't know how you put it. But we've got a lot of activity out there. And we know from what happened with the Trump administration that micro-targeting and the best use of social media by the Russians is what got him there. That got him that little extra margin that got him over the top. So we have to look at a concerted effort to make our social media hit the spots that we can. It takes some coordination of the massive lists that the party has with outside lists, Facebook lists, purchase lists, so that we can slice and dice that audience of voters here in this state and get those voters that are interested in something what they want precisely. And we have to do it that way because we are once again going to be outspent by the Republicans. So we have to use what's relatively cheap and what's extremely effective, and that's micro-targeting. And I think that's something that we have to build on. I think in terms of keeping the peace within the party, that's another thing that the state party chair has to do. I used to work for Cliff Larson. I was on state party staff many years ago. If you remember Cliff Larson from back in the 70s, he was the fellow that started the First in the Nation caucus. And he did it with through strategy and patience. What happened is they made a decision that they wanted to become First in the Nation. And then they simply waited. I was a college kid, and I went down to the state party headquarters between the holidays, Christmas and New Year's. And there was one guy in there that many of you probably have met, Richard Bender. He was a staffer for Tom Harkin. And Richard was on the phone when I went in, and he was nodding, And you know Richard, if you know Richard, he talks like that all the time, Well, finally, Richard got through his so he got off the phone. He said, that was Arizona, and they're going to have their caucus this date. And he circled it on the calendar. And he says, because of that, we're having our caucus this date. And that was how the First in the Nation thing started. It was waiting, seeing the opportunity, and moving when the opportunity was present, quickly to take it. And they took it, and it's been ours ever since. And we want to keep that because it does have value. But we need to bring the rest of our Democrats home. You know, we've still got a lot of people that when the Dem exit happened down in Jefferson County, I know there were a tremendous number of people that changed their registrations. We lost people during that. We need to talk to those people to bring them back into the fold. Here on the Central Committee, I think we have a fairly relatively even division, and some of the anger is filtering out. We're starting to become unified, but we still have to work on the message that will unify us all. And Scott Cohen's down here, when I was talking to him just now, talked about the three things that he thought were important as a single unified message that we can work off of. One was jobs and income. One was education, and the third was clean water. I think if we focus on those three, and then the bad cop comes and yells about the debt and the bad things the Republicans have done, I think we're gonna win. Now, I think I'm the person that is able to do this for you. I've been around, I've seen a lot of things in this state. I have traveled as a staffer and met county chair and county chair and county chair. As a candidate, I've done the same thing. I can do it again, and I can bring that body of people together, and I can be the bad cop so that we can get a good cop elected as governor, and we can fill the legislature with good cops, too. Thank you for your time.
Go ahead and stay up here, and then what we'll do is that we can open the floor to questions. And so we'd like to keep this fair as possible. And I think it's fair to let the other IDP chair candidates also question the candidate that's up here, because I think that that is a very fair thing to do. This is a friendly competition, yes? So if the other candidates would like to ask questions of the candidate that's up here, are you guys agreeable to this?
Yeah, I don't have any questions for
you. I don't either.
No questions?
I would rather talk about the focus that I have, and I'm sure that's what Troy and Bob want to do.
Are you guys okay? Everybody's agreeable?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Okay. Because I kind of was wondering, because we didn't talk about that as a rule earlier, I think it's a fair thing.
If you are open to it, it might be best for each of us to speak, and then we'll all come back up and answer questions together as a group, if that's okay.
That would be a good system.
Do you guys like that idea?
That usually happens.
Okay. You want to vote? Everybody say aye.
Aye.
Okay. All right. Fair. Well, that's right. Okay.
Thank you.
All right. Who would like to go next?
Troy.
All right.
Oh, now you're tall.
I'm tall. I'm not used to being this high.
Yeah.
Yep. Well, good morning.
My name is Troy Price. First of all, I want to say thank you, Shelley, and to the Veterans Caucus for giving us this opportunity today. I've actually been coming to Veterans Caucus meetings now for, this is my fifth year, since 2012. So it's good to see so many good friends, so many new friends, folks I look forward to getting to know here over time. Also want to say a special word, well, to our Vice Chair, Andrea, good to see you up here. And also want to say how honored I am to be sharing this podium with my good friend Julie Stouch, with my good friend Bob Krause. Had opportunity to work with both of these folks over the years, and they are fantastic Democrats, fantastic Iowans, and very honored to be a part of this group. So, as I said, my name is Troy Price, and I am running to be the chair of our Iowa Democratic Party. Let me just say, I'm proud to be a Democrat. I'm proud to be a Democrat because I'm proud of what the Democratic Party has done to create social change over the last 80 years. I'm proud to be a Democrat because it has given a voice to the voiceless, and I'm proud to be a Democrat because of what this party has done to fight for people like me. I grew up in a small town, Durant, Iowa, over by Davenport. I can assure you that this town was not a bastion of liberal thought when I was growing up. Being a young closeted gay kid, it was tough. You had, I'd grow up and I'd watch TV. I was interested in politics. I'd watch TV and I'd see the Republicans on TV talking about how people like me, how gay people are not allowed to, or should not have rights, should not be a part of our society, should not be involved in making decisions and having rights in our country. And what was more disturbing about that is that when I would go to school, when I would go to the coffee shop, see my grandparents and their friends, when my parents would invite folks over to the house, those same points that the Republicans were making were being said there. Even though this was my hometown, I didn't always feel welcome there. But in 1998, I decided to go volunteer for the Iowa Democratic Party. I was a senior in high school, decided to go volunteer ahead of the 98 election. And there, I did feel like I was welcome. There, I did feel like people respected LGBT folks. Not just LGBT folks, they respected everyone. It was a place where I felt at home. And so that is why I'm proud to be a Democrat. That's why I've been proud to be working in Democratic politics over these last 15, 20 years now. It's why I've done the work that I've done. I've worked for two Democratic governors, working in the messaging shop there, helping to put together their message and spread it across the state. I was the executive director of the Iowa Democratic Party 4 years ago, helping to put together the largest coordinated campaign the state has seen in a non-presidential year, raising $8 million for that program. Also working to expand and empower the various levels of our party, starting with the state central committee, starting with the district committees, the county committees, and the different caucuses within the state central committee, to make sure that those folks, those people, have the resources they need to be successful and do the work that they need to do. It's why that I have worked for several statewide campaigns, including two presidential campaigns, and it's why that I was the executive director of One Iowa, the state's largest LGBT organization, right after the Supreme Court justices were kicked off the court, and a time when we didn't know if marriage equality was going to last in Iowa. We worked together to put together the plan, the program, and organize to make sure that happened. So that is why I've been proud to be a Democrat, and like many folks, I'm frustrated by where our party is today. We know that we've seen that the party is not speaking to the people that we are trying to help the most. That we have seen folks who are part of working men and women who have voted for Donald Trump. We have seen people who we have been fighting for and talking, trying to talk to, but our message is just not getting through. I've seen that we are running programs that continue to grow more and more out of date, more and more antiquated. We have to do more and we have to do better. And so we have a rare opportunity right now with an unpopular president, with the GOP that is currently pushing a far-right agenda that isn't just turning us around, it's shoving us backwards. We have an opportunity now with a lot of activists that are now empowered that we see in rooms like this, not just here, but all across the state, activists who are working hard every day to try and turn this around, turn our country around. We have an opportunity. But the only way we're going to utilize this opportunity is if our state party is strong, if our state party is active, and if we hit the ground running. And so that's why I'm running for chair, because we need a chair who can start on day one. And I bring not only just my experiences, I bring my commitment, my passion, and my vision to to help turn this party around, to help move our party forward, and to and by in the process turn that turn our state around as well. And this is a process that isn't just about a chair. Party is not just about a chair. It's not just about a candidate. It's about people like all of you. And I want to work with all of you, and hope to work with all of you, if I am so fortunate to be elected chair, to help do that and meet the challenges that we have. The things that we need to tackle are: we need to strengthen our relationships. Okay. We need to strengthen our relationships. We need to strengthen our relationships to not only organize across the state, but to raise money. You know, it's an unfortunate reality that I wish money just grew on trees or that money was readily available, but we've seen that the Republicans have plenty of it and we don't. We have to be building our relationships all across the state so that we can tap into those resources, put together the programs that we need to put together a strong campaign for the fall or fall of next year. We need to build a unified message. One of the biggest challenges that I've seen as a party is that our message has been fractured. It's been very specific on certain issues, but never provides enough heart, never provides enough vision for what we want to do. We need to identify that message. We have the tools to do that with this Building Blocks program. We can get that done. We can do that. We have to do it right away and start making sure that everyone on the ticket, from the State Central Committee, county parties, et cetera, but also our candidates, are all speaking from the same hymnal. So we have to build a caucus to convention process that is strong, that is transparent, and that is fair for everyone. We have to support our identity caucuses, like the Veterans Caucus here, to make sure that these groups have the resources that they need to be successful. They are our messengers to different groups that we wish to tap into. We need to make sure that they have the resources they need to be successful. Finally, we need to protect our First in the Nation status. We are under attack. There's no question about that. And we've got to do what we can to make sure. I've worked at the DNC, with the DNC before, to implement expansion projects through the caucuses, and we'll look to do so again. I'm running for chair because I can hit the ground running. We've got tremendous challenges. We can meet them all together. Folks in this room and folks in rooms all across the state will help us do that. And so I'm looking forward to running for chair so that we can rebuild our party, we can build a progressive vision for this state, and we can move our state forward. So thank you all so much, and look forward to talking to you, look forward to the conversation. Certainly have more to say. Sorry I ran out of time, didn't realize how long my speech was. And look forward to talking to you all. Thank you.
Formal and friendly, and we could just, you know, take a deep breath and be ourselves and be approachable to one another and just relax. Just deep breaths. This is a friendly atmosphere.
Good morning. I'm Julie Stouch, and thank you very much for the opportunity to be here today. I have been a Democrat my whole life. I started as an activist in Cerro Gordo County, where I was a precinct captain and worked on the County Central Committee. And then we moved to Des Moines after 10 years there, but that's when I got into politics, is in Cerro Gordo County. And since then, the door came wide open, and I've done many things. Andrea asked me when I arrived here, give me your 30-second introduction. And my 30-second introduction about my bio is, I've run 3 congressional races in 3 different states. We won 2 of them, and the 3rd one, we were the closest in the country in a challenger race to almost win. We went to bed thinking we had a recount, and we woke up and found out we did not. I helped elect the first immigrant woman to the U.S. Congress in the work of doing that. I worked for Congressman Leonard Boswell, who I'm sure many of you know. I have a story to share there, but I'll finish telling you about this first. I'm sure everybody probably has a story about Leonard. I see you laughing. I had the opportunity to train and do advance for Vice President Gore and President Clinton, which led to doing many large events around the country, actually around the world. And so I have a interesting past that has been a lot of fun in terms of my political involvement. But I started in politics, because Ronald Reagan did something really awful, which I frankly can't remember which one it was, in November of 1983, and I literally found myself standing at my TV set screaming, and I sort of had one of those moments where you stop, you're sort of, you're outside looking at yourself, and it's like, you know, that's not really healthy behavior. And so I decided I needed to get involved. I had always voted to that point, but that's when I got involved. And that has, that drive to help other people has kept me engaged in the process and kept me engaged in doing the hard work, the mundane work of the effort. I'm running for chair because right now we need a chair who understands both how the process works, because that you have to understand to lead the group, but also understands how leaders institute change. And in the last 5 years, that's the work that I have done with a wide variety of organizations to help them to work with the leaders of nonprofits, of for-profit organizations, to help make things happen that they want to have happen. And I think that quality, coupled with my experience, really helps position me for this role. Now, it doesn't mean I'll get elected. That's up to other people. But I think it positions me nicely. My story about Leonard Boswell. I ran his campaign in 2002. He had just been redistricted. 73% of the district was new. And I was on maybe not even 10 days. And the congressman was starting to try to do my job as well as his job. And so I was trying to find a way to tell him to focus on being the candidate and I'll focus on being the campaign manager. And we were leaving the office to go to a meeting. And just outside the office door, he started talking about his military career. And I thought, of course, that's perfect. And so I said, you know, congressman, if I had been in the military, I know what my rank would have been. And he looks at me and he goes, really, what? And I said, I would have been a master sergeant. And he stopped walking, and he turned and looked at me and he said, Julie, the master sergeants run the army. And I said, that's my point, sir. I run the campaign. You're the candidate. Well, of course, he laughed, because he's a good guy with a great sense of humor. He laughed and he said, I get it. And we worked very well together, except for a little bump over yard signs, because he loved yard signs. What can I say?
Yard signs don't vote.
Here's what we need to do together, as both Troy and Bob have recognized as well. We need to focus on two main points. And if we focus on those two main points, we will get the other pieces that have to happen in line. The first point is we need a chair who will focus on raising money. Because in order for our candidates to win next year, we need to have $4 million to leverage more national money so that we can carry on the work of turning out the vote for all of our candidates. Secondly, we need to focus on how we connect all of our people. Right now, we have, I think some good progress has been made since last winter. But last winter, when I went out and talked with folks around the state about the party, we had some real disconnects out there. And I think progress has been made towards that, but a lot more needs to be done. And so those two things are the priorities for us. Out of that concerted effort, we can show a united front, not in sort of fakey, you know, oh yes, we're united, and then go in the corner and squabble or speak poorly of each other, but in a real, authentic way, show that unity. And that will help us on many, many different levels. It's not a job a lot of people want, and I think we can do this. I'm actually excited about it. I wake up every morning with another idea of another way to bring in people, and I see Troy nodding. I'm sure he does too, and Bob. I think that this challenge is real, and that the time is about to run out. So I thank you very much for this opportunity, and I look forward to your questions.
Guys have had to say. You all had some very good points. So what I'd like to do is find a way, how would you all be comfortable? It was kind of separated out into two tables within the middle.
Just sit
we can just put
sit
three
one.
Of them.
Yeah. We all like to chat. I see that. I see we have no going on. That's so awesome. Yeah.
Where do you want to sit, Bob?
I don't care.
Tables together.
You have touched briefly on this, and so within the framework of the leadership of the IDP, as a veteran that has. In bringing in votes in each county. How can you leverage that as a chair of the IDP?
Who wants to go first?
I'll take it.
Having been a chair of this caucus once upon a time, I can see the pattern, and it's identity politics, which is a very strong underlying tone in any voter identification project. You know, you look at the Latino vote, you look at the women's vote. People often, not always, but often will make their first decision on who they vote for based upon identity. And that was the logic behind the creation of these. I think the trick ultimately is to balance the constituency caucuses and the geographic caucuses. To make sure that one side doesn't overweigh the other. But I do think one of the big things we do have to do to make them work right is to resource them. And I would like to thank Derek and Kevin Geiken for what they did to the IDDC just this time around. We went and we got the list of the Veterans Tax Credit people around the state. They took that, they sent it to the DNC. The DNC collated it into more usable data, targeting veterans and getting into the database. And I believe that's why Kevin sent out that email to everybody, because he said he was going to have that ready about now. And two or three days ago, I got that email. So we need to do that for every constituency caucus so that they have basic contact tools and they can use them through through an emailer that's inherent in the party. And that way we can keep the emails and the fresh data internal. It doesn't get bled off by consultants.
Well, yeah, and that's a perfect example of something that the Veterans Caucus is working on so that we can help update the van and help build our caucus and do voter outreach all at the same time so that we specifically are doing before the 2018 election cycle. So we are doing multiple things to facilitate growth before the voter cycle. Because when we have candidate buy-ins, we want to give them a good product. So that's kind of where my question was going. So I'd like to give you guys the opportunity to answer that question as well.
Sure. The role that I've always
from my time at the IDP before and now. When I look at the different caucuses that are out there, the system is kind of a twofold approach. One, it's message in and message out. We look to the constituency caucuses to be the voice to the state party, to provide that voice and make sure that the issues that are important to that particular caucus are at the forefront of the state party in general. So we look to them. They're the advisors on the issue specific to each caucus. It's also to push our message out through through their caucus and their membership on what the state party's doing. And as part of that, the second piece of it is just to organize and to get folks organized out there. What I've seen a lot in the last couple of years, and I've really been excited about it, particularly in the last year since the convention and whatnot, we've seen a lot of great organization happening within all the caucuses that are across the state. And so, obviously, the Veterans Caucus is doing great. I was at a Black Caucus meeting in Davenport in May that was tremendous. There's a lot of great activity happening out there. And so to make that happen, to allow, we have to provide, to make that happen and make sure that the caucuses have the ability to do that, we have to provide the resources they need to do that. And not just in terms of, not just in terms of like, you know, money or something like that. It's in terms of like, that's part of it though. One is, you know, providing literature and providing pieces that can be handed out and that sort of stuff. What Bob is talking about here with updating the van, making sure that information is in there and making sure that's consistently updated so that it's not, it doesn't get stale, because as we all know, the information in the van can go stale very quickly. But also one thing that I think we can do to help empower the different caucuses is to help them raise money. And help them raise money to support themselves. Because, I mean, that should be a goal that we should have, is that caucuses are able to help sustain the work that they're doing. And so, you know, using the fundraising resources of the state party to put together fundraising plans, to put together different ways on how you can do that, utilize emails, utilize et cetera, stuff like that that can help allow these caucuses to be more empowered and free to do the work that they need to do.
Thank you, Troy. I appreciate that so much.
Yeah. To me, the fundamental purpose of any of us in the Democratic Party is to build relationships with voters and with our neighbors and friends so that they also join us as being Democrats. They respect our point of view, they respect our engagement, and so what the caucuses, what's valuable about the caucuses is you have relationships with people. There's no way that we can have any of us who are sitting working in an office in one city, it doesn't matter which city in the state, can have relationships with people in all 99 counties. It's the people on the ground locally who have to do that. And so veterans need to have those relationships, women need to have those relationships. It doesn't matter which affinity group you are a part of, that's what really makes our party work. And so to me, it's all about driving the tools you need to you to build those relationships. That's my answer. I really think it's all about the relationships and whatever tools.
We know voters often vote based on emotion, not necessarily facts. So that's
people will sometimes ask me, where did you learn how to participate in politics? And I tell them, go join a religious organization, because those are the most brutal politics you'll ever face in your life. And you know, and I'll just end that with an amen.
All right, I'd like to recognize Laura.
All right, hi, Laura Huffman from Howard County. You all know me. Specifically to veterans and our political party, we seem to have ceded the military and any veterans to the Republican Party. Rod Blum is continually having, you know, veterans job fairs and veterans meetings, and we don't see a lot of our candidates or, you know, having these forums where they talk about to veterans and about veterans and actually showing what we're doing to support veterans. We're not vocal enough about that. What would be, I guess we'll start with Julie, since you're
okay.
What would be the first thing you'd want to do to get, you know, the veterans out there as chair, like to encourage?
Here we are!
You know what I mean.
Oh, okay, I thought you were gonna go in a different direction with that. So
I want to say one thing on a part you made there about the veterans forums that the members of Congress have. That actually started with Democrats years ago, because when I was working for Leonard, that was something that they were encouraging all the congressional staff to do across the country, was to have these forums. And then the Republicans picked up on it. To me, the big distinction between our two parties is that the Republic, and I'm going to use the military because it's a fabulous example of it. When you look at what is done to help our veterans, you have to look to Democrats to do that work. But when you look at what's done to help the military-industrial complex, that's the Republicans. So they all make a big hoo-ha about campaigning, about how they're going to fund, you know, the Pentagon, and they're going to fund all of our military resources. But they don't fund our soldiers and their families, and that, to me, is a piece of that. Now, that doesn't answer what you asked, Laura, specifically to what you asked. Along that same line. There's no reason we couldn't do any of that. You know, I think it's certainly something that we could add.
Congressman Roosevelt has done that wonderfully. Just to say, I was at his yesterday.
Uh-huh.
He's been eight in the last 3 days.
Yeah.
I wasn't invited. I'm chair of the Veterans Caucus.
Yeah, I just got my notice of being informed.
So I think that, the first thing I would do is put together a message plan. Put together a message plan for the caucuses. I think we should do that for all the caucuses anyway, but specifically for the Veterans Caucus, you're absolutely right. We have ceded this ground. We have let the Republican Party say they're the patriotic party and that we are the party that isn't, and let them define us that way. We have to take that back. And so we need to put together a strong message plan. And you know, like, the people in this room right here, this is great. I mean, we've got, what, 20 people here, 25 people here? Each and every one of you could submit an op-ed. Each and every one of you could submit a letter to the editor. Each and every one of you can do something, and not just in, like, the big city markets and stuff like that, but, David, you're in Allison, Iowa, if I'm not mistaken?
Parkersburg,
Iowa, sorry. But, you know, send it to the local newspaper there. Do this not just in big newspapers, which is what we always tend to do when we talk about op-eds. Do it in smaller markets, get that out there. I agree with Julie. We need to do forums and do some of that work as well. The third thing we need to do, though, as part of this message plan, is we need to talk to our candidates and make sure they're not afraid to talk about it. Because I think that's one of the things that we have done as Hardy, is like we've allowed it to happen, and so therefore we just don't talk about it enough. We have to not be afraid to talk about these issues and make sure that they are doing that and provide them the resources to do.
Talk about how Trump is making veterans lose their VA disability when they hit Social Security age, when they're rated from 60 to 100%, and then this puts them in abject poverty because they haven't ever made enough money to even rate a Social Security wage.
Yeah.
These are the things that we have to frame as a message and put out.
Okay. Yeah, I think Troy is right. The message plan is important. And, you know, I'll take credit on the individual unemployability. We put that out under a post on Facebook and under the Veterans National Recovery Center, and it had we had about 20,000 views, and I think about 40,000 that read it without opening up the video, which was the highest that we've ever had. And what is happening today is that Trump is trying to get money to do some of the things he wants to do. And what he's trying to do is he's trying to go in and raid that money, not only from this, from the disabled vets that are severely disabled. He's going after the homeless, he's going after the housing money, he's going after a lot of things. A lot of people that, because the number of veterans in the nation is relatively a low number now, a lot of people don't realize that most veterans don't get a pension. Many veterans don't get VA for health care. We have an entire zone, if we talk about the LGBT caucus or something like that, we have a huge quantity of people that were dishonorably discharged and they're still hanging out there because
there is, it's a difficult process to go in and get the records reviewed. What we do is we point out what the Republicans are doing wrong and what we can do better, and that is message.
Yeah, so we'll get back to the framing on the message. So I'll need to recognize you. Yes.
Yes, I'm a really old from Franklin County, and I don't know if it's from a Hippocratic Oath or what this word, I think it is, but if the Central Committee could hang a big banner across the room that says, first, do no harm, because they have, and they've done it consistently. The second thing is that the caucuses are different people, different attitudes. They run at a different speed. And there's a tendency, no matter how hard you stomp it down, it keeps coming back. We're gonna put together a plan for how to run the caucus. Recognize we are all enthusiastic people about the things that we support. And we have a different approach and a different method that we accomplish that. And so I implore you to listen to the veterans, and if this wasn't a veterans caucus, but any caucus, I should say, if they come to you and say, we would like to do this, you know, give them some leeway. I mean, I'm to the point where this past year, and I guess over here I'll confirm that, but a few months ago, I resigned from the Central Committee of the 4th District. I resigned from the Veterans Caucus. And I resigned from the county office that I held. I call myself a Democrat, spelled with a small D. But we have a great organization. We really do. But I don't know how we continually sidetrack huge opportunities. So again, hang that banner high that says, do no harm. Listen to the caucus. And because there's not a lot in the Democratic Party rule book on how to run the caucus. And I think somebody had a lot of wisdom when they left that part out. But anyway, thank you.
Thank you so much for being here today. I'm so, so grateful for you and your wisdom and your courage. Thank you.
So can we comment? Shelley, can you comment on what was just added?
Whose respect and honor him?
Yeah, I agree with you, and I think one of the things that we have to look at, there is a model that if I were elected chair that I would recommend you seriously consider, which is actually one that came out of Iraq. It's from a book called One Mission, and what they realized was the bureaucracy of the military organization there was getting in the way of fighting insurgents. And so they didn't eliminate the bureaucracy because there was some strength in that, but they created alternative paths for communication. And when I read it, I thought, that's just what we need, because they were having the problem between, where even between, for example, SEAL teams or Ranger teams or Marine teams, they were not communicating. They had their units with which they had great brotherhood and collaboration, but they weren't working across the board. And how do they get them to work together? And how do they get them, most importantly, to share information? And I think there's a real opportunity there for us to recognize that our teams are our county parties. Our teams are our caucus groups. And we need to better facilitate how they do their work. Not to say, you must go do this, but to say, here's our end goal. How do you want to help? How are you going to contribute towards that end goal? And how do we help you then contribute that way?
Thank you, Julie.
Well, first of all, I completely agree, Larry. Do no harm should always be, first, do no harm should always be what we do when we look at any problem. Sorry. Do no harm should always be what we first look at when we are looking at any issue facing the party. You know, I completely agree with you too, Larry, that we need to listen more. And one of the things that I tried to do when I became executive director, one of the concerns that I heard when I first started applying for the job and reaching out to state central committee members was a concern that they were not being utilized well. They were meeting up 5 times a year,
voting on stuff, going home. There wasn't much communication. There weren't much interaction with the state party as a whole. I worked hard to really try and change that and make sure that we were listening to them so that this wasn't a two-way street, or this wasn't a one-way street where the chair, the ED, was standing in front of the podium and saying, okay, here's what's happened, vote on it, thanks, have a good night, here's lunch. Like, we really worked to make sure that, like, we were trying to make this very much a collaborative process. It's very much how I've approached things. It's how I tried to approach it when I was on the Central Committee and working with the Veterans Caucus then. When I was at the State Party working with the Veterans Caucus then. And would certainly try to bring that again if I'm so fortunate enough to be elected.
Well, keeping in mind that we, Veterans Caucus, made up of veterans. And the thing is, we were taught one thing, how to fight, right? Mm-hmm. That's what we were taught, how to fight. And so don't get too excited, don't get weary if we, the veterans, fight a little. You
know,
can't take it away.
They yes. Yeah, this for those of you that have been around. So we always have to kind of keep our head down, and you know, and I see it, and it's somewhat a unique problem with the IDDC, because we occasionally do have some people that have post-traumatic stress disorder, and they blew out their filters. And so a confrontation that may be dinner table talk somewhere can escalate. And it's something that we as veterans have to be conscious of, that there are people out here that have shorter fuses. But you also have PTSD and shorter fuses in all those other caucuses too. Sensitivity is number one.
We don't own PTSD, first of all.
Yeah.
We don't own it.
Yeah.
It is a valid diagnosis, DSM-10 diagnosis, and we are not the only ones that have it. Mm-hmm. And that has to be recognized.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. And I think that what Larry is saying is, first, do no harm. I think it's be respectful, you know. Trump has been our role model, unfortunately, and it's allowed us to engage in fisticuffs that, you know, 20 years ago we wouldn't even think about. And so we've got to get back to an old-fashioned standard of decency when we're conducting meetings and we're conducting the business of the party and when we're doing outreach. We can reserve our fighting and our punching for the bad guys. We know who the bad guys are in this case, but inside we got to keep civil.
Introduce yourself.
I'm Mike Madsen from Davenport. Thanks. Glad to meet you guys. So I've traveled around about 25 counties in those 3 months and talked to a lot of folks. To me, there seems to be an overriding concern. A lot of people in our party have individual particular issues. And so I've even heard many of them say, well, I'm not going to vote for so-and-so or so-and-so unless they follow so-and-so. Or unless they are here. How do you get all of our party together? Because Trump won this state by 10 points. And it's pretty splintered now in our party. And that seems to be the case. How do you, as a leader of our party, get everybody in all these different factions and all these different ideas together to get behind whoever our nominee is for governor? Because there's a lot of enthusiasm. How do we keep that? But there's also a lot of fractions. And we say we're the party of everyone in United, and we kind of are, but we're all over the place. And if we don't get ourselves together, we're going to have Ms. Reynolds or Mr. Corbett be our governor. And so I think that's the number one challenge we have, and at least I've seen in all the places I've been. So
let's keep it to 3 minutes each. Julie, I'll have you go first, please.
Okay. What we really need is a clear common goal, and to me that common goal is there anybody in the room who doesn't know that we need to win this next time around? We need to win. And in order to win, we have to focus on those things that help us get to the win. And so I am a very active pro-choice woman, and I will be meeting Democrats who think otherwise. That's okay. As long as they vote for Democrats, I don't care about that. I care about getting Democrats elected. I care about, because there are just going to be people you disagree with anywhere. I mean, at home with my husband, for goodness sake, you know? What matters is that we focus on the win. And to focus on the win, I believe we have to focus on our local races, and that means our legislative races. Because winning doesn't go top down, winning goes bottom up. And our people, we need to focus on our legislative and local races, because that's where the winning will come from, that will carry our governor candidate, our statewide candidates, and help us make the change we need.
So I think when we look at the division out there, there's not a lot of difference in what our goals are, right? The difference is just how we're going to get there. We all agree that minimum wage should be higher. We all agree it should probably be $15 an hour, right? We just disagree on exactly what the path is to get there. And I think all of us can agree that minimum wage. All of us can agree that everyone should be making far more than the minimum wage in their life. Same on healthcare, same on education, same on job creation and economic growth. It's really just about the path that we get there. That's where the disagreements I feel lie. But we all agree on the same common goals, and that's what we have to focus on. And so when we are putting together a message for this coming year, we need to make sure that that's a message that can permeate everything and that everyone is talking from the same way. The example I use of this is in 2002, Vilsack and Harkin were running for re-election. The theme of the campaign that cycle for the Democratic Party, not just for Tom Vilsack, not just for Tom Harkin, was hope and opportunity. That was the tagline. And so that was what the focus was going forward. And so everyone was speaking from that. And it was a fairly, it was able to penetrate into the psyche of the party. And so other candidates are doing that. We have to do that again. And it goes down to like state house, state senate candidates. We have to get even more localized than that to our county parties, to our county candidates. Make sure that everyone's saying the same thing, because the Republican message is so easy. The Republican message is no, and that's, they're consistent in saying it. Our message always ends up being a little bit fractured. We always end up talking about different things. You know, there's some candidates are gonna focus on Medicaid privatization, some candidates wanna focus on human trafficking, some candidates wanna focus on education funding, etc. So we're all just saying a bunch of different things, but we're never saying what it is that we are going to do. What's our vision? Why people should be voting for us? We have to come up with that. That's what we have to do. And that's how we kind of get the party back together going forward for 2022.
Years ago, when Noah was still getting the animals to go up on the ark, the Democratic Party came up with an issue book. And Art Small did. Art Small ran for Senate. Some of you may know Art. He was quite a character, a funny guy. He used to describe how they do it in the minority in the House. He'd say, well, you know, the bills would go flying away up there, and we'd just throw up an amendment like that, but shoot, every now and then one would come tumbling down. And he did that with controversial issue after controversial issue. And then he took those, and he had the party line votes, and he made books for every legislative candidate in the state. And it had about, five or six really, you know, hot issues. And this was in 1972, when McGovern was going down bad. In Iowa, we gained, I think it was like 10 legislators in the House, and we gained a bunch of legislators in the Senate. And we only lost McGovern by 4 points, you know, which was phenomenal compared to the rest of the country when he carried Massachusetts. So the unity message was out there because we had that book that Art created, and it had all these different issues, and it says, this is what they did wrong, this is what we want to do right. We can do that. We can have that book recreated. It doesn't have to be in a binder, although a binder is nice. It can be electronic. But we need to have the workshops. We need to get it out there. And we need to have that. You can still have your own message. You can still be a legislator and say, well, we ought to redo the Lotz Creek Bridge or something like that. But you have these other issues, and you can throw them out there as they come up. And that creates a cacophony,
Is that how you pronounce that? Cacophony?
Cacophony.
Yeah, that word. That you need to get the buzz to win the election.
I'd like to hear from each one of you.
Please introduce yourself.
Oh, I'm Scott Phones, running for Iowa House District 68. Kent Reiser.
Although Ken is also a veteran, kick his ass.
He doesn't have. With you guys' help, I certainly will. In order to know how to win, it's usually a good idea to know why you lost. I'd like to hear from each of you just very briefly, why did we lose? Not presidential, I'm not interested in that, I don't care. Why did we lose the House? Why did we lose the Senate? Why have we lost our Senate representatives? Why is it that Rob Blum is still representing the first district? What is it that causes us to lose?
I'm gonna very quickly say, I appreciate your question and I will appreciate your answers, but let's do it in a way where we don't touch on anything like Bernie or Bust or the Democrats.
Well, he said to leave that out.
Leave anything.
I'm not interested in presidential. I don't care.
Thank you so much. I appreciate that question.
Do you want to go first this time?
I think they did micro-targeting and we didn't. And I think it carried over from the Trump campaign. When you get to the margin that he won here in Iowa, and it was clearly the landslide effect. It used to be, I don't know, it's the same number, it used to be the landslide effect started coming at about 57%. And he was in that zone, and we lost in a sweep. And I think it's the momentum from the top carried the rest of the ticket down.
Okay, Troy.
So I think it comes back to messaging, and it comes back to I've had a front row seat to this over the last couple of cycles, and I have seen that what we are selling, people just aren't buying, and so. What it comes down to me is, Democrats have focused way too much on tactical or specific policy stuff to try and get ahead. And it goes back to what I was just saying about, I know like certain legislative candidates last cycle were focused on human trafficking because some polling said that human trafficking played well. Different campaigns were focused on privatization stuff. Different federal races, whether it was the Clinton campaign, whether it was first, second, third, fourth, whatever, we're all focused on different messages as well. We didn't have anything that unified us, and we were all talking about all of it was very important stuff, and certainly very important stuff to our party, but it didn't fit into the overarching message. People didn't feel that we had their backs, that we cared for what they cared about. And so that's what it boils down to. That's why we lost in 2016. That's what we need to do different in 2018. Because if we're not all saying the same thing, if we're not all out there talking about this, the Republican message is still going to be no, and ours has to be that we are going to help move the state forward. And then everything else that people want to talk about can fit under that umbrella, but we have to come up with that top of the pyramid message there that everything else can fit into.
Thank you,
Troy.
I would say that it's slightly different. I would say, first of all, we haven't been recruiting people to run for every race, and we have to do that. You can't win what you don't put people out there, what you don't have to go after. So that's one reason. And when I'm looking at it, particularly legislatively, I'm looking at the win is not just you winning, Scott, it's winning the majority. And so we have to look at both of those together. Then the other part of it is about the relationships. And people want elected officials that they relate to. And they want to know them. And for all that I think Donald Trump is evil incarnate, I mean, there are people who believe because they get his Twitter posts that they respond to him, and I bet you he never reads a single one, I don't know. But they believe they have a relationship with him. And so that changes how we do things. But I really think a key word for us is, are we building those relationships? And how are we building those relationships? So the best thing that we've ever seen that works for our state house candidates and our Senate candidates is at the doors, because you're building the relationship. And at coffees, you're building the relationship.
that's what really helps people tie in. And so it makes it hard, I'm going to, you know, pick on Mike, it makes it hard for a guy like Mike to come out and run, and I thought he brought a great deal to our governor's race, because everybody in Scott County knows him, but the rest of the state didn't know him. We have to also help our people in office have those relationships so they can move up to run for governor, because we need those people in those places. So, anyway, that's my.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Appreciate it.
Over here?
Please
introduce yourself.
My name is Eric, and I'm from Waterloo.
Eric from Waterloo.
My name is Eric from Waterloo. So my question is, how do you get Democrats to want to run as Democrats instead of not putting I'm running as a Democrat on their campaign signs or their campaign literature? They need to say, like, I'm running as a Democrat and then I'm proud of it or something.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Something to that effect.
All right, I'll take that one. I think that we have to show them that we're proud that we're Democrats, first of all. You know, I mean, and that we're confident about being Democrats. That makes people say, yeah, I want to be a part of it. But I do think it's about the relationships. I think the other piece of that is it really helps if they have a local issue that they can get behind, because that really gets people locally engaged. You know, I've been helping in, what do I do?
We just,
oh, proud to be a Democrat. Oh, that's great. And I've been helping in West Des Moines. We've been recruiting candidates. We hope to have a full slate of people for our school board and municipal races. And I've been having conversations with people about how to run and everything. And one of the things we're really trying to do is just build those relationships. Some people are going to run this year. Some people are going to run in 2 years. Some people want to run in 8 years. It is a slow process. But the thing that we're finding in West Des Moines that they're uniting around is they really hated that water bill. Bear in mind, we were the only metro city in 93 that didn't lose our water. And to talk about regionalizing it, everybody who was living there then is like, you know, they're just like wigged out about it, including Julie Stouch. And so we've got people running for the municipal offices because of that water board thing. So look for those local issues too. I think that helps, you know.
Well, the local pride is
a Go ahead.
It was me who poked.
Okay. I didn't poke you.
I poked.
Oh, okay.
Local pride. When I ran for state legislature, we had some big orange signs that said "Proud to be a Democrat." You slap them on the cars. You slap them on the shirts. And so you go down through a county fair, and everybody was proud to be a Democrat. And it really took off. We haven't done anything like that. We our party literature, when we have it, it may be a supplier to stick in a door. But I don't know the last time, and maybe you can correct me, there's a time when we had a proud to be a Democrat or a Democrat thing like that. Yeah. But it has to be something that's quick, easy. That builds it up. Beyond that, I think if you give them issues through a standard message that they know, eventually they're going to decide that it is better off to be a Democrat because everybody is talking the same thing. And I think it kind of comes together in the wash.
All right. Are you all done?
Yeah, I am.
Troy, would you like to speak?
Yeah, I don't disagree with anything that Julie or Bob said. Democrats should be unapologetic about being Democrats, plain and simple. When I was ED of the party, I traveled around the state a lot, and there's great Democrats all across the state, don't get me wrong, but like some of the most fierce Democrats I've ever met are the ones in Western Iowa, because if you're going to be a Democrat in Western Iowa, you have to be, you're going to be facing some headwinds out there. And, you know, that's what we have to do all across the state.
Headwinds, tornadoes.
But we just have to be unapologetic about being Democrats. no one should, to your point, Eric, about people should put their Democrats on their signs. They should do that. They should do that, and they shouldn't be afraid to do that. And we, to do that, though, we have to create the environment where it's safe for them to do that. And that means that we as a party have to make sure that we are doing that, not just from the state party, not just from a building on floor, but from over at all levels of the party. We have to not shy away from any fight. We have to not shy away from any criticism that might come our way from the Republican Party. We just have to keep meeting it head on. So,
could I have an alibi?
I actually would like to add something to what he's saying. We also have to make sure that every Democrat of every different breed and color within the Democrat Party feels welcome inside, yeah, once they're on the inside. Yeah. Because that's really what I'd like you guys to address. I'm going to add to his question, and I'm going to put you all on the spot. Because we have progressives, and we have centrists. We have the pendulum that I spoke about in my opening statement. What will you do as chair when we have state central committee meetings and we have to do votes and we have to do resolutions and we have to come together and we have to meet and we have to get stuff done, and you have all different breeds of Democrats? How are you going to make things happen and get things done and have unity? Go ahead.
Well, one of the things I think we have to do is help people understand what they have in common, even when they're in different groups. You know, help them find what they share. Whether they may not share a common belief about a particular issue, but there are other things that they have in common, and help them understand that and see that they can work with everyone. I think as far as the bigger question of access for everyone, it really comes down to respect, and we have to practice respect. And sometimes for some people, it requires practicing, you know, and not just automatically feeling that way. So we have to cultivate an environment where we practice respect.
Cultivating a respectful environment. The fiercest, most activist Democrats you will ever meet are in the SCC.
I want to say one more thing, to go back on the point that was made about Western Iowa by Troy. I always think, someone told me once that they felt like they were a career military person, and they felt like I was a person who was always at the point of the sword, and I didn't know what that meant. And then they explained to me what it meant, and I think we have to look at our Democrats in Western Iowa. They live at the point of the sword out there. They are really at the heat of the battle, and we need to be, you know, we need to respect that what they accomplished there is different from what we're going to accomplish in a Dubuque or in a Waterloo or in a Polk County, where we have a whole different environment, and we have to respect that diversity.
Thank you. Joy.
So, we are the Big Ten Party. We are the ones that, where everyone has a place to feel welcome, and we have to make sure that we foster the environment that does that. Julie's right, we have to show everyone respect. We have to listen to everyone. We have to, you know, and we have to not be afraid to have hard conversations. Like, I think that, you know, traveling this state over the last couple of years and seeing that there are divisions within the party, that there are concerns within the party, that there are people who are at loggerheads at times, it comes down to the fact that there's just a level of mistrust out there that still somewhat permeates in certain parts of the party. We have to go out there, we have to build that, or we have to tear down that mistrust and build up the trust within the party. And so, starting with different entities like the State Central Committee, I think that we can build that trust through action. I think that we task people with, you know, if everyone's just sitting on the side of the room and no one's in the middle doing the work, we're not going to get much done. No one's going to talk to each other. We have to get everyone into the middle of the room, working together. And through that action, you're going to see that this mistrust is going to go away. So we have to lead by example, the State Central Committee does. And if I'm fortunate enough to be chair, I'll try to foster that.
I didn't hear the last three words.
If I am fortunate enough to be chair, I will foster that. Try to foster that.
All right, thank you, Tom.
Well, I think the constituency caucuses are a big part of bringing it all together. And I say that because it allows people to define their issues amongst friends and associates. They don't have to go out into the broad body before they find their coalition. They can find it right there in that room. And, you know, we have a variety of caucuses, and we approve more every year. You know, if there's somebody that's really into duck advocacy, we will have a duck caucus.
Okay.
But it hasn't happened yet.
Uh-huh.
But I think that civility, emphasis on decorum, those are big things. And then I want to say something about Western Iowa. We had a congressional candidate that was forced out of the race by threats, by death threats, by intimidation, by soft law enforcement, and then we don't have a candidate out there yet in Northwest Iowa. And we talk about, well, we don't need Western Iowa because they always lose out there anywhere. Look at the vote totals out of Blackhawk County. Look at the vote totals out of Polk County. Each of those were won by a few thousand votes, not very much. You know how many votes they, which county canceled out Polk County? The last time we won Polk County? Sioux County. They carried Sioux County, a county of probably more than 15 or 20,000, and it was carried by 10,000 votes. That is where we are losing our elections, because we are no longer competitive in Western Iowa, and we're competitive in Eastern Iowa, but not enough to make a difference. We need to work those people back. It means playing a little more of a hardball game out there, as you have to, but we need to put money back in that area. In fact, when Kim Weaver was knocked out of that race, there were people on Facebook, and there were a number of them, that were saying, well, that's just good that she got out, because we can take that money now and we can throw it into Eastern Iowa.
Okay.
That's not helping us.
I'm going to recognize the question.
Madam Chair, point of privilege.
Yes, sir.
Just a heads up for everyone. This is streaming on the internet, and the microphone is over there pointed toward our candidates. So when you're asking your questions, please speak up.
I appreciate you so much.
Got to bounce it off.
Thank
the
you,
wall.
Vice Chair Mike Jesse. I'm going to recognize. I know. Okay. I recognized him first, and then went on.
Yeah, my name is Pat Morrissey, and I'm
Speak up, Pat Morrissey.
My name is Pat Morrissey, and I'm the Ward 3 councilperson for Waterloo.
Thank you, sir.
And I'm here because I was invited by Jerry Hagman, who was elected.
Thank you so much.
Thank
you, Jerry.
One of the things that my daddy taught me was that all politics are local. And I haven't heard you guys talk about that. And I know that municipal elections are supposed to be nonpartisan. But where's the Democratic Party in producing candidates that are good progressive candidates? What happened at the state legislature this last year? State legislators, senators, or the legislators can go home, but people that face the music are your municipal elected officials. Because we're the end result of trickle-down economics. And it's trickle-down economics, which means the federal people can run, we're going to cut your taxes. Then the state people say the same thing. But then when it comes to local government, what happens? We got a choice between either raising taxes or cutting services, cutting people. And that's what's happening.
Yes.
And where's the support from the Democratic Party? Democratic Party can support us. We just don't run as Democrats or Republicans or socialists. Or fascist, or whatever you want to call yourself. But we need support. And we don't see it there. Municipal elections are, other than school board elections, are the most poorly attended elections that there are. And why is that, Democratic Party? You know, if you want, rather than looking at money to come in, why don't you look at your local candidates and what they're doing as far as getting grassroots involvement so that they can get elected? Because one of the things that you guys don't mention is the huge amount of disenfranchised voters that are sitting there that don't ever get a door knock, don't ever get a phone call, but they need to hear a message, and not a corporate Democrat message. They need to hear a message about what is important to people. And such as I hear, you know, number one thing that you want to run on. Well, the number one thing you should run on, to me, is rescinding what the Republicans did to the people of Iowa and the cities of Iowa, and what they're going to do next year They're going to offer you this real nice tax cut, but at the same time, they're going to take away the backfill that's going to cost the city of Waterloo $1.8 million coming in. And you won't hear that from them, but we'll hear it. Get progressive people, because I can bet you a dime against a dollar that Americans for Prosperity and those kind of people are going to be backing their candidates to ensure that they get in to make government not just smaller, but almost non-existent.
Yeah, that's the home rule bill again. So what we probably need to do is establish those signposts so that the people can come in and air these grievances and then hear these things over and over again so that we can frame those messages back to the people so that they know what it is that we're doing for them, mm-hmm. is what I'm hearing. They need to be heard.
Do you want us to respond to the statement?
I
actually have been doing that work in where I live, you know. So that's the hard thing now. We need people doing that everywhere, and we've been recruiting candidates. We have been helping them build the connections, precisely because that commercial property tax bill change a couple years ago is going to leave our cities, our counties, and our schools in a whole world of hurt. And we want to make sure the Republicans own that world of hurt. And in order to do that, we have to have the candidates in place who are dealing with it, who will speak out about it. The Republicans in the city council where I live right now will never speak out about that because they're a part of it. So we are trying to get some Democrats in so that they will be the voices this fall and next year about how hard the city's being hit, so that we can help our legislative candidates have a local person stand up and say, I want Scott there because Scott's going to deliver on this because this really screwed us up.
I completely agree. We have to do more on the municipal and local election side, and particularly now with this new collective bargaining bill that just passed. This is where the fight's going to be now for labor, for public workers in the state. It's going to be on these, who's going to control the boards that are going to be deciding the agreements that are going to be made with employees. And so I think that while that bill is a disastrous piece of legislation, it also gives us another opportunity for us to empower people and get more people involved in this process, because it's going to be more people, because these elections take on even greater responsibility now in this environment. So I think from what the party can do, one is the biggest thing to me has always been training, and what's one of the things that I tried to do when I was EV before is try to implement a training program across the state that empowers people to get involved and to examine the idea of running for office. And so understanding, because I mean, making that leap to run for office is a hard thing to do. You know this, like, you know, it's not like you wake up one day and say, oh, I'm just going to run for office. Like, you know, you have to put some thought in it. You have to think, this is a lot of responsibility. Do I want this job? Blah, 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 blah. And so that folks understand exactly what the job is, what the task is, and to give them the tools that they need to be able to run. And so I think that's what the party can do. And then we do have to do a better job this fall and every other fall, focusing on these municipal elections and school board races, because they are incredibly important. And I think we have as a Democratic Party, have a responsibility to do education about that, because people, the low voter turnout stems from the fact that we just don't have, folks don't realize that these elections are happening. We've got to do a better job, and we can provide resources to local county parties that can allow them to help spread the word about these elections and their candidates that are running in those races.
Thank you, Troy.
I'm not sure of the number now, but about 10 years ago, it was between 70% and 80% of all school board members were Republicans. I don't think the city elections are much different, especially if you add in all the small towns. And what that does, that has and is very effectively created a farm team for the GOP that we do not have. Where do they get their people that are trained, that can think, that can talk in public? They get it from school board members, they get it from county supervisors, they get it from city council people. It may be an opportunity here to focus
a constituency caucus on this area, because the people that are in those local local elected official positions today, they are going to be the ones that best know how to write the apple cart. Right now, we don't have much out there, and we need to get those local officials involved and maybe have their own caucus and give them some resources. But we need to turn that around, and it is local politics, because those local people are going to be our next state senators and our next congressmen and our next senators. We need to take care of that.
Thank you. I'd like to recognize Bernard.
I'm Benoit Clayton. I'm the vice chair of the Black Caucus of the Democratic Party of Iowa. Anyway, I'm going to ask my question. There's a lot of questions I can ask you about. And by the way, I want to thank the Veterans Caucus for putting on this forum. I thank y'all. Should be commended for that.
Thank you so much. You did a great job.
My question is, you say the party has to have a win. And what I do, I look at pictures. I look at pictures of lynchings, and I look at pictures of the Holocaust. I don't pretty much look at the victims, but I look at the faces of the people who are perpetrating those crimes. And so far, I have participated in two protests against Donald Trump. And I've met his people coming out, and I'm not saying all of them, but I've met his people coming out of the auditorium. Many of these people have the same looks that lynchers and SS people had in their face. As I see. Now, I know we got to get the win, but how does this party get the win without giving in to the racism, the homophobia, and all the other phobias that we do? Is this party going to do a Bill Clinton to get elected again, or are we going to stick to our principle? And then I know winning's not easy. I know we in it to win. I clearly understand it, but my thing is, me personally, you don't do certain things to win. You know, and I don't like losing. And in the history of black people in this country, we win, but most of the time we lose. And if we do get a game, it gets taken back. The Voters' Rights Act of 1965 basically is non-existent. Brown versus Board of Education, essentially schools in America are as segregated as they were before the 1950s. So we enter this thing. So again, how do we get a win without becoming moderate Republicans? And then how do we deal with that racism, that racism and all the other isms that are present in our state that propel our legislature and our wonderful President Trump to his position? And again, I'm not so much focused on President Trump. It's the climate in the country. He's simply the spirit point of it. Mr. Cruz could have easily inserted him in his place, any other Republican. This is something that's been going on for the past 40 years. So he just happened to be the guy that's doing it. So how does our party deal with that?
Troy.
Troy, go first.
Troy, yes.
Are you talking about like what Pate did with the new like voter registration laws?
No,
is there something specific?
Okay, this is what I'm saying. One of the things that, you know, we don't talk, one of the things that we failed to mention, one of the driving things in this election, when we get to all the technical things that went wrong, and we're not going to get into that right now, one of the big underlying issues of this thing is that there was a segment of the white population that wanted their country back. Black folks were taking stuff from them. Immigrants were taking stuff from them. Gay people were threatening them. There were all these kinds of threats. And the Republican parties were able to use this fear.
Yes, they did. Right.
They were able to use this fear that we are white people. We're becoming small. We're not populating in the way we used to. And these people are a threat to us. And they're taken away from us. They are barely taking away our livelihood. And they are undeserving.
Yes, sir.
So that's the question. How do we not appeal to their politics and still get people elected?
Thank you so much.
Well,
who would like to go first?
I'll go first.
Go ahead, Troy.
There's absolutely no question that the climate in our country is disastrous and that everything that you said is true right now. And what we have to do as a party, first of all, we can never compromise on our principles. We just can't compromise on our principles. We are the party that ushered in the Civil Rights Act. We are the party that has stood up for the LGBT community, the African American community, the Latino community, women, AAPI, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, all down the list. We are the party that has always been the party that stood up for that. And if we start compromising on that, then what's the point? And so we can't allow that to happen. And we have to make sure that we are pushing our candidates constantly. And from a party, we have to be able to have open and honest conversations with our candidates to make sure that these issues are going to stay in the forefront. We can't just like try to sugarcoat it or whatever else. We have to go out there and make sure that we are pushing our candidates to keep on these messages and keep these issues on the forefront. So that's how we do it. And you know what? If we do need to win, we absolutely need to win. But we have to lead by example as a party to change the culture that exists in our environment. So we need to not be afraid to talk about these issues. We need to not be afraid to stand up for what we believe in and what we believe in, what every group that is a part of the Big Ten of the Iowa Democratic Party, we need to make sure that we are not afraid to stand up for them. And so, you know, whoever the next chair of the state party is, can never compromise on that, period.
I agree. I think that you brought up a really good point. You know, we have no hate. That's all over the internet. That's all over different arguments we have. But really, it's about fear. We have to fight fear. We've got a bunch of people here in Iowa that have been able, the Republicans have been able to pump that fear button. You know, it's fear of terrorists. It's fear of black people. It's fear of gays. It's fear of this group, that group. We have to develop as part of our big message that we are the party that is not afraid, that we fight fear. We fight the fear of the people around us. And it's a message thing to some extent. We also have to enforce it when we see things. We should be on the front line of working with the different civil liberties and civil rights groups to do lawsuits. Some people say that fascism is a creaking tide. It's an avalanche. And you can see it. You know, think of what life was like before the election, after the election, a week from the election, 2 weeks from the election, and today. You can see the forces that are going out against the media. You can see the incremental cuts and the reversals of policies. It's not all overnight. Get a calendar. When you see something that you think is different than it was the day before, where it's more oppressive, mark it down. Mark it down on a list. And it will instill in you the courage to see what's happening and know the direction we need to go.
After the Civil Rights Bill passed in the 60s, a subset of the Republicans focused in on how do they fight back, how do they stand for what they still believed, and how do they fight back. And there's a college professor who's written a book, which frankly the book is very tedious, but there's some videos where Bill Moyers interviewed him on dog whistles. And one of the things we have to do is every time a Republican blows that dog whistle, we have to call it for what it is. We have to call it for unwritten racism. We have to call it for sexism. We have to call it for what it is. And we have to recognize it and expose them and make them very uncomfortable for using that language. In my grandfather's generation, in terms of racism, there were words that were used that we don't use anymore in polite conversation. But they're now using different words. And we have to recognize that just because their words changed, it didn't change what they're doing, and we have to point it out. I'd like to share one short example. A friend called me. He's a lobbyist, so he has to go to everybody's events, right? He went to a Republican event, and he heard the governor of one of the southern states start off and say, "I'm proud to be at a gathering where we have the freedom to pray to our God." And he said, he called me and he said, "I'm having a hard time figuring out why that's wrong." And I said, "That's a dog whistle. That's a dog whistle implying that if you weren't in this room, you don't have the freedom to pray the way you want to pray."
and you do anywhere, or not pray at all. You can do it however you want. But the point is, this was an educated man who is very progressive, and it sucked him in. It sucked him in. So we have got to be aware of those things, and we've got to help ourselves push back against that and say, you just blew a dog whistle. I'm on tense terms with my sister because I blew a dog whistle on her, and she's not happy with me. So I've not been getting any phone calls, which sometimes that's okay. But
anyway. We only lose the freedoms that we give up. I'm going to recognize.
I just want to say one thing.
Thank you, Bernard.
Book you're talking about is Dog Whistle Politics by Mr. Lopez.
That's
good book
correct.
To read.
Thank you for your question.
It's just
thank
really
you.
Bad.
Thank you. I'll
excuse me,
you.
Ma'am.
Hi, I'm Dave Mance. I'm Butler County Democratic Chair. And I'd just like to say you don't have to go very far west to hit Republican headwinds. 30 miles will do it.
Yeah.
I had tires punctured on two different cars the week before the election. So it's not, it's all over. We've had a good discussion here about the nature of the Democratic Party and messaging. The Democratic Party in many ways is like, to men, we need a gathering of the clans, like the Scots do, because we've got all these constituent groups, we've got all these issue groups, and when we get them all together, we can win. It's a difficult job. Like the Scots didn't win very many wars because they couldn't get the clans together. Now, we tend to, you know, love messages, our issues, and we've got position papers on everything. What we tend to forget in elections is that, go back to your high school experience, the most likable person wins. Ultimately, that's what it boils down to. Those 99 position papers aren't read. People vote with their gut. So, since we have so many messaging and it gets diffuse, you know, like Troy was saying, and it gets vague and we have to sharpen that, but the job of, I bring this back to the job of the state chair, you have so many hats to wear. You have to be a major fundraiser. You have to be, and Bob was saying, you play good cop, bad cop. That's fine. But you have to be a cheerleader for the party. You have to be an organizer extraordinaire. You have to be a media guru. You have to be a PR specialist. You have to be an articulate debater. And there's so many hats that you have to wear. You have to be a political strategist. Is there a danger in wearing so many hats, just like our message is so spread out and diffuse, that you're paralyzed because there's so much to do? What would you focus on and why?
I'll start on that one. I would actually look at it, and I know about all those hats, and I actually had someone talk to me about, well, are you comfortable doing press? Well, yes, I've done press. But quite frankly, I wouldn't really worry about Julie Stouch being the face out there necessarily doing press every time. We have some great people. Let's find out what the topic is and put our people in front of, in different places. So that's one thing I would do. But for me personally, the two things I focus on is raising money and building those connections and the communications out to the counties. Because we win or lose in our counties. We don't win and lose in the chair's seat. We win or lose in our counties, and so we have to focus there.
I would focus on first piece is obviously fundraising. It's the necessary evil of politics, and it's something that we have to do to make sure that we have money to fund the campaigns that we need to run next cycle. And I think we would take a look at specifically some different ways of fundraising, doing some joint fundraising with county parties. Trying to expand small dollar stuff, but also we need to start bringing in at a lower level folks who we can start moving up the ladder of financial engagement, because the donor base of the Iowa Democratic Party has been shrinking substantially in recent years because we haven't really grown our donor base, and it has quite frankly, a lot of folks are passing away that used to give us money. So we have to start building that out and repairing the relationships with some of our institutional funders. The second thing I'd focus on is messaging. I agree with Julie. It's not about the state party chair being on a soapbox and ranting and railing and pounding around. It's about using what we have available to us. One of the things that I used to do when I was ED of the party, we always used Mike Fitzgerald as a great messenger to talk about economic issues. And he's much more of a credible source than the state party chair is to talk about financial issues, you know.
I wasn't mocking you.
No, I know. So, you know, but it's really just about messaging in general, getting that down and then just never letting up and constantly being out there talking about why the Republicans are bad and, more importantly, why Democrats are better. For the other hats that you talk about, I would look to empower the State Central Committee and create different people and empower people within the committee to be able to tackle these tasks, because it is too big for one person. I saw that firsthand when I was down there. Like, it's a huge job, and it is, you know, you have to have good staff who are working down there, but you also have to have good people that you can rely upon on the State Central Committee, and quite frankly, throughout the state, at the district level, at the county level, that you can rely on to get those things done. And so that's what I would do to make sure that, because the job, it all has to get done. But we have to make sure that we are tapping into all the resources available to us.
I think as I look at it, I look back at the memorable state chairs we've had that were generally regarded as effective. But I think you'd have to look at Lex Hawkins, who was a bad cop model. And he was Harold Hughes's party chair. And you'd probably have to look at Dave Nagel, who, when he was party chair, did about the same thing. You need somebody that really pisses off the Republicans. That's what you need. And, you know, I can do that. Other people can do it, too. And there's ways to do it and mix and match and put people around in different parts of the state. And it works. But I think it is a necessary task, because that way you focus the hate on somebody else, and then the governor can go out there and the governor candidate can be above the storm, the nice guy, and he wins. So I think that's part of the dance. I think the other part, obviously, is the money. And what Troy has pointed out is very accurate. We don't, you know, people used to give $50 you know, back in the 1970s, they're still giving $50. It hasn't grown, and part of it is because the median income in Iowa has gone down. You know, our base is getting poor, and what do? They still may give you know, 3 or 4% of their income, but it's less, and that's what's happening to us. One of the reasons we need to talk about things like income is because our people are being hurt by it, and it's hurting us in our Democratic pocketbook. So we need to work that, and I would agree it's got to be the blend, but we've got to work on that small contributor base. Bernie Sanders showed what can be done with that, with the right kind of message. And if we get that base, if we get that enthusiasm, the big money will come too. And there, of course, we've got to be careful that we don't get swallowed by the big money. What's happened is we've been so poor at the bottom that somebody comes along and they dangle a bag of pennies for us. And, oh, we need that. And it causes problems. And generally, we're immune from that, but every now and then it happens.
Thank you. I'm going to take two more questions from the audience. I'll take three more questions from the audience. And then we're going to do closing remarks, and then we will adjourn at 11:30. So he's been waiting a long time to ask a question. Please introduce yourself.
Yeah, I'm Tom Powers. I'm a Ward 1 councilperson. I won a special election last July. And I had to run. I've been doing politics in this town for almost 40 years. But when I left NOM, I was upset with things going on.
Thank you for your service.
Okay. And I didn't want to. I never wanted to. Everybody knows. Never wanted to be able to kind of push a button in an election. I want to help people get elected. But a wise person once told me that it's easy to fire your business.
party. Quickly, okay. Bob, you go first.
Good question. I think one of the things you need to do is, especially if you got time, sometimes things happen rapidly in politics, but if you can put out an ad, something as simple as an ad with the requirements for the office, post it on the website or something like that, so you get a good mix, and post it in other states. I do find that as I go around Iowa, that a lot of people have a bad taste in their mouth from out-of-state staffers, because come in, they scramble the egg, and then they leave. There's a function for that, but it also creates problems, so I probably would give at least initially some kind of favor to local candidates, perhaps if they were locally recommended or something like that. But we need to have that out-of-state talent too, so I think it's a mix. But you start with a job description, you interview to the job description, and you hire to the job description.
Thank you, Bob. Okay.
For me, what I look for when I hire hire folks in positions like this, I put together campaigns and I've put together different organizations in the past. What I look for people like that is someone, one, who can complement my leadership style. There's certain, I'm not looking for someone who is the exact same as me. That is never, it's never going to be helpful. You need someone who can help fill in where you may have deficiencies in your, certain skill sets and stuff like that. Secondly, I also try to look for diversity when we're hiring, because I think that there needs to be diverse voices, and it's easy in a state like Iowa, and this is something that Democratic campaigns have combated quite a bit, but it's easy in a state like Iowa that is 85% white to end up with a campaign that is 95% white, and I've seen that happen quite a bit. And you need to make sure that you have a bunch of different diversity on the campaign to make sure that those voices are being heard throughout. And so that is how I approach, that's how I approach hiring.
Thank you, Troy. Julie?
Like Troy, I too have done a great deal of hiring, both nonprofit and then in campaigns, and also on large events. And the thing I look for in people I hire is I like to ask them to tell me about a time when you had to deal with, and then I lay out what the problem is and hear how they've already done that, because I want people who have some experience in what we're asking them to do, unless it's a truly entry level position. So I'm looking at their experience and how they do that, because we need to have people working who understand what the problem is going in, not coming in and needing 6 months to learn the problem. They're going to need 6 months to learn all the people, to learn all the relationships, but they ought to come in understanding how to solve the problem. The other thing that I look for is how do they complement the team we already have? I think that we have a good team at the party right now. In fact, it's a team that's short of people, and we need to add some people in. So how do we complement the team that's there right now and expand upon that? And at the same time, I'm always looking at a wide range of diversity and gender balance issues. But I would also add, given this past election, I think we really need to make sure that we have working men and women as a part of our team. And by that, I mean people who have, with this current city council work I've been doing, one of the guys who is a city councilman who's running is a laborer. He is actually technically an AFSCME member. And it helps that he is a part of our team, because he is giving us a perspective on a part of our community that wasn't at the table before. Thank you.
Thank you, Julie. Thank you. I need you to say your name again. I can hear you.
Yes. First of all, President Obama, I would look to him. I watched him. I heard him speak at Phil College in 2007. Blown away. Nobody's been able to do that to me since. So, thought we said sooner or more, thank God, but he was able to address issues without making people feel bad. And when he had a large rally, he made you feel like you were the only person in that room he was talking to. So how do you train leaders to speak like that? I have only really voted for people that have come to my living room, ever. And in the primary last year for for the Senate, for people who are running against Grassley, I live in Ward 1, Precinct 2. And my polling place, out of 1,900 people that were eligible to vote, 152 came. That has to change. That's just shameful. And then I keep hearing the word progressive. And not just here, but on Facebook, on TV, wherever. They don't think that there's one definition of progressive.
The purity standard. Absolutely. Thank you for that.
Yep.
I guess I go first this time, unless Troy wants to.
You can go for it.
Okay, so you covered several different things there. I think fundamentally, what I heard you saying is that we need to have, you vote for candidates you have a relationship with.
Exactly.
I think we all need to hear that, folks. You are not alone in that. A lot, that's what everybody does. Some people go out and aggressively reach out to get those relationships, but not everyone does. So we have to plan for that in how we do our work. As far as helping people be speakers like Barack Obama, good luck with that one.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, let's be fair. But what I can say is, for our candidates, we can create more opportunities for them to have exposure to speaking. And some of that starts with getting them elected to city offices and giving them an opportunity to be there and lead, or to school board and on up the pipeline, so they cultivate that experience. Some people are just naturally born talkers.
I'm not.
But you did very well. Thank you.
My first speech in college, I quit breathing.
Oh,
you did fine. You did just fine.
No, I did.
All right, go ahead, Troy.
I completely agree. I mean, it's going to be very hard to find the next Barack Obama. Not everyone will be Barack Obama.
Here's an example.
But what I think, the lesson that I took from, you can take from Barack Obama, is that not only was he a great messenger, he was a great messenger for the time. And remember, at that time for our country, was the politics had gotten, are certainly not as toxic as they are now, but the politics were not great. And he came in and he had a message that didn't have us focusing on the divisions that exist within us. He had us looking above it. And I think that's really the message that I, or the lesson that I take from Barack Obama, is that as we are going into this election cycle, I mean, aren't we all just tired of being angry all the time? Don't we just want a day where we don't turn on the TV and we're not having to be bombarded with some crazy thing that Donald Trump said, or how everyone's all angry at each other and da da da. I mean, it's just, I'm sick of it. Like, you know, it's exhausting. And it's exhausting as a party. We as a party have to lead by example and go out there and talk about, you know, it is about hope. It is about change. Not to use slogans, but that's really what it is about. We have to provide the electorate here some hope, you know? And I think that that's our key to success in that cycle, is we just have to give them some hope that things are going to get better, and that you don't have to live in this toxic stew of politics that we are currently involved in.
Yeah. Hope is about empathy. The ability to sense your feelings and moods. Bill Clinton, I feel your pain. I feel your pain. You feel my concern. It might just be one of those things that some candidate training in a workshop where we pack up the issues like we always do, but how do we teach somebody to meet somebody, to talk to them? Not everybody's a born salesman. Just some introductory things on in the workshop. First of stretching the workshop out, it's just a tiny taste. But we were all born with empathy. but some of us hide it better than others, including Donald Trump. And we need to work on that. If you work on your own emotion, your own inner emotion that you feel for these people, the rest of it's going to kind of come to you. You know, because I can't see you, struggling to get, food for your child or something like that, and not feel an empathy, But I've got to know why you need my empathy, and I need to give that to you. And I think some of that is just, you bat them on the side of the head and say, this is what you have to feel. You have to emote, you have to give that empathy, and maybe just a block of instruction. It's not, you can't do everything, but you can start with that.
I guess my goal is delivery. Delivery is in person or in a big crowd is extremely important to the Democratic Party, and we lacked this last time.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, Bob Kresig. I was going to get here. They must have had the form for the veterans.
That's it.
But sorry, I was late. I had some other stuff. But I've run 7 races at the state level, and I've won 7 as a Democrat.
Thank
I think
God.
That's kind of a rare story today to hear. But I have the greatest respect for Tom Harkin. That guy, he knew how to get elected. He knew what to say and what to do. But what we have as a Democratic Party, we have a top-down mentality. The upcoming election for governor, if we continue to focus on the top-down, in other words, governor, Congress, state senate, state rep, city supervisor, city council, board supervisor, Tom Harkin said we need to focus from the bottom up. And if that's what's been going on, folks. I'm just telling you. They bring staff people in from North Carolina, New York State. Now, I'm not going to be critical of them, but to be honest with you, the people in North Carolina are not like the people in Iowa. It's a different concept. I've knocked on thousands of doors, literally thousands. And I've talked to people personally. That's what they need. So if we as a party, and I understand you three are running for that leadership, we can't continue that. We have to reach out to people and talk to them. And people like these two here that are running for city council and our county supervisor seats, those are critical. I think we need to focus from that way up. So that's, I don't need an answer, but I'm just telling you, I've run my own campaigns for the last 6 campaigns. I've had some help, but by and large, I do my own thing. I do it here locally. I buy media here through locally, create ads. I just think that's the concept. That's what we need to focus on is, because at one time, we were in the majority in the Iowa House. We have 41 seats now. We've been decimated. We've lost some really good legislators. That's the reason.
I have a question for you. How can the legislators work together with whoever's going to be our next chair and run campaigns where we're having a message that springs together instead of having 20 different campaigns with 20 different messages?
We don't necessarily talk to them on a regular basis. Our interaction is with staff that they house themselves in this room. They need to get to know us. I mean, who knows better the people in House District 59 than Bob Kresig?
Yes.
Who knows people better than Tom Powers? And so that's the disconnect.
Yes,
they take orders from somebody in the hierarchy in Des Moines, and they're going to do this. I just tell you, when Obama ran the last time, we tried to get together when they hold events here. They wouldn't tell us nothing. It's very frustrating. And the data van, The information that people collect for other candidates, we don't get access to that.
That's true.
The only access that we have is what we generate. But I can guarantee you they're probably getting access to our information on the band. So if they want to work they want to work together, I'm more than doing it, but I haven't seen it.
We talked about that earlier because the candidates are being forced to buy into that, and then the IDP is fundraising off the candidates.
That was my second question.
And I'm going, why?
Well, I just want to say thanks, Bob, for reiterating my talking points from earlier.
Oh, okay. Well, I'm sorry I didn't hear them. But
that's okay.
Thank you very much. Okay, so please respond, and then this will be your closing statements, and then we will adjourn. Unless anybody else has a question. Are there any more questions? And we need air. We can't breathe.
I think these guys want to respond to Bob.
Okay, so you each get 2 minutes to respond to Bob Pressig, and then you'll get an additional, just go ahead and wrap it up in like another couple of minutes for a closing statement, and then we need to adjourn because there's another meeting.
Yep, go, Buck.
Please,
on.
On, we can't read.
I'll take the lead on it. Yeah.
Yeah, go ahead. Respond to Bob, please, 2 minutes each.
Yeah, all politics is local. All politics is face-to-face. All politics is a relationship. We've gotten into a lot of mechanical, and what we've done is we put the blinders on, and we say the mechanics are good without remembering what the heart is. And I think that's the message you had. And we need to, and it's been brought up here in many questions, we need to work on the local level. We need to tie our staff people to the local level in a better way than we've done historically. And we need to have them and candidates be empathetic to those around them. That's it.
Thank you.
I think we can just all admit that the coordinated campaign model we've been operating under for 25 years doesn't work anymore. We have to be open and accept that's a reality. And we need to build a new coordinated campaign structure. Coordinated campaign, such as it is now, was originally created here. It was a Tom Harkin creation, I think 96 maybe, or 90?
80. Oh, the 80s.
Okay. So, and that's the basis of which, and it really hasn't fundamentally changed too much since then. We have an opportunity this cycle to build that new coordinated campaign. It's got to be one that focuses on the local level. It's got to be one that focuses on 99 counties. Julie's absolutely right. We need to run candidates for every seat that we can. Including state house seats, including local seats, as much as we possibly can, and encourage county parties to do that. But the coordinated campaign has to be able to build and help folks support those candidates when they're doing it. I mean, the fact is that these coordinated campaigns, and I've seen them, end up being so incredibly focused on just one structure. It's a one-size-fits-all cookie-cutter thing that they plop into Iowa, and they plop into Wisconsin, and they plop into wherever else, and like there's no localization, and there's no ability to change that. And that's crap. I mean, we're not going to win with that sort of model. So we have to build a new coordinated campaign. We can't rely on folks to just come in every 2 years and build it in 5 to 7 months. That's why we have to build and focus on our infrastructure generally, so that there is, when folks do come in for the campaign at the end of the cycle, there's already something on the ground that they are plugging into, not the other way around. So that's how, that's the answer to your question.
And I answered Bob already because I agree completely. And so,
well done, candidates. Well done. All right. Would you guys like to?
Go fight win.
Go fight win.